fellowship, what a joy divine, leaning on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so near, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning, leaning, leaning on the everlasting arms.
Sixth sermon. And it's going to be at 2383 Grover Hall Road. Go down 129. I forget the name of the road you turn left up on. You go up to Grover Hall Road. We'll be back in there. So let's remember that wedding. That'll be at 6:30 Friday night. So, try to remember that. We got many families we need to remember. We need to remember the Parham family, as Johnny lost his brother. The Miller family, that was my daughter-in-law's dad. Renee, she lost an aunt. And also the Bobby Brown and Gail Britt family. We've just had five in our area this in the past week that's lost loved ones. So let's remember these. Remember Terry Jackson. Tomorrow they sent him to St. Thomas. If everything checked out the way they meant for it to this weekend, we're going to try to put stents in Terry. So let's be much in prayer for Terry. They say otherwise, he is doing pretty good, the last I heard. I hadn't heard since Friday. So let's remember him. Continue to remember Philip Nelson as he's taking his treatments and they're really dragging him down. So let's remember Philip. Always remember Terry Taylor. He goes back to the doctor in about 4 more weeks, I think. And maybe he'll know more. And the list just goes on and on. We've got just numerous names. Any other announcements or prayer requests that I'm forgetting?
Don't forget to remind
Okay. And that made me think Teresa's sister's mother-in-law lost her husband too. And what'd you say those names were, Rocky? Any others? Yes.
My two grandsons are going to be traveling this evening to Eastern Kentucky with their work. And this, I guess, they have a place to go.
All righty. Okay. Anyone else? Nothing else. This morning, Greg, would you lead us in prayer, please?
Father, we come to you this morning, Lord. Father, just thanking you, Lord, for allowing us to be here this morning, Lord, together once again. Lord, just to spend a little time worshiping, Lord, praising you, Lord. And Father, just hearing your word this morning, Lord. And Father, just lifting all these prayer requests up to you, Lord. I know that you know what's going on, Lord. You're on top of it, and nothing surprises you. But Father, nevertheless, Lord, I just pray, Lord, that you would be to each and every one mentioned here this morning, Lord. Father, just comfort them, Lord, in a way that only you can, Lord. Father, I just pray, God, that the eyes would be open today, Lord, that the hands of Satan would be bound today, Lord, that your word would go forth, Lord. Father, I just thank you and praise you, Lord, and look forward to what you're going to do here this morning, Lord. Always come expecting, Lord, and Father, you never fail, Lord, and I just can't wait to see what you're going to do this morning, Lord. Father, we just ask that you be with each and every one of us, Lord, every household represented here today, God. Lord, that you would just be with us, Lord, be guiding the direction of, Lord, in all that we should be doing, Father. Lord, we're just always
and I don't know if any of you will have to be in the Life Center, but we had a water fountain that sprung a leak this morning. We have got it cut off. The bathrooms and everything else is back operational. The only thing not working is the water fountains.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Good to see all of you. We're going to start off this morning with a little Heaven's Jubilee, page 258. Some glad morning we should see Jesus in the air, coming after you and me, joy's ours to share. What rejoicing there will be when this thing page 265, sweet by and by. Page 113, just over in the glory land. Again, so you got to keep in line up here.
Honor someone that's fallen. He was one of us. So we're always honored to do that. One of the first times in my life that I actually wanted to go to jail and they wouldn't let me today. They stopped us from going in this morning. And they've got several cases of COVID with the women there. I don't know how much the men have, but Don, y'all need to be aware of that. I don't know that y'all get to go Wednesday. They shut the main jail down, so I don't know about the RC yet. So we'll find out. But it's been a good week, a productive week, and I pray that you come expecting a blessing today. I pray that the Word of God will speak to your heart today, and He'll change hearts and lives forever. I do want to say thank you to y'all that play the music and work on the sound and production, the live stream. I know y'all put a lot of hours, a lot of work into that, and the quality, everybody's telling me the quality of the pictures, the sound, the movement of the camera is a whole lot better. So thank y'all for what you do. So I hope and pray that, you never know who's sitting in their living room watching a live stream or listening to the Word of God that would fall on their knees there in the living room and be saved. Matter of fact, we've got some testimonies about that. But anyway, remember that, and I thank God for the opportunity to be able to reach out to the world, not just to our congregation. But remember every church around us, every church seems like since the pandemic is struggling, and now the epidemic is getting rising back up with the COVID, or so it seems. And it is what it is, and we have to deal with it. But for those of you that have been here through the duration of the pandemic, you know that we didn't miss a beat. If we had COVID, we moved in the parking lot.
Praise the Lord.
We just took whatever had, we worked with it. God just continued to bless. We wasn't God. Listen, God ain't dead. God doesn't have COVID. So he's still worthy of our praise and our worship. That's what we're going to do. If it gets to an epidemic state, we'll move back out in the parking lot. Me and Joey had a big time out there for you. Don, you need to get a hold of that. We'll get together and we'll do whatever it takes to worship God. You can worship God sitting on a stump by yourself. Amen. All right, let's receive the offering this morning. I do want to get a group together. I don't know. Have we ever taken our kids to Safari Park, Gene?
No.
We need to do that. I was down there this week at that Tennessee Safari Park. It's not that far. It's about an hour. And I think the adults would have a blast. The animals actually were hilarious. Buffalo trying to get the car with me. I'm serious. They was after that food. We all take the gift now. That'd be great. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for today. Lord, I just pray that you would meet with us here this morning. God, as you did with Solomon at the temple, Lord, I pray that you just fill this place with your glory. It would be so thick, God, that we wouldn't be able to see. Our eyes be filled with tears. God, we just feel your presence in this place today. Lord, I thank you for what you're going to do today through your word. Use it for your glory. Hide me behind the cross. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What's my name? Amen. That's what Brayton. God's name. Amen. Come to you, Lord, just thanking you for this beautiful day you've given us. Lord, I pray, God, that you would take this change offering that we're about to receive. God, you'd use it for your glory. Wherever you send it, God, may it bring a smile upon a child's face that you might be known to them. Thank you, God, for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Jesse, was that Christie's dancing over there last night? Yeah, I thought it was. I never will forget one time we were taking up this change offering, and Jerry Jewell was sitting about where Joe Don is, and Kevin Kurtzinger was sitting behind him, and Jerry was visiting with us, and Jerry asked Kevin, he said, what are they doing taking up two offerings? And Kevin told him, he said, well, this is just a change offering. And Jerry said, well, what do they do with it? And Kevin told him, that's what they pay the preacher with. Amen.
All right, let's go to page 265. Sweet by and by.
Bye.
have your Bibles turned with me this morning to 1 Chronicles. 1 Chronicles chapter 21. I told you Wednesday night, I've told you this many times, the Word of God will do one of three things. It'll make you glad, sad, or mad. So just pick which one you fit you most. Or if you would, if you're able to stand as we read the Word of God. 1 Chronicles chapter 21. Let's begin in verse 14. 21, verse 14. So the Lord sent pestilence upon Israel, and there fell of Israel 70,000 men. And God sent an angel unto Jerusalem to destroy it. And as he was destroying, the Lord beheld, and he repented him of the evil, and said to the angel that destroyed, "It is enough. Stay now thy hand." And the angel of the Lord stood by the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. And David lifted up his eyes and saw the angel of the Lord stand between the earth and the heaven, having a drawn sword in his hand stretched out over Jerusalem. Then David and the elders of Israel, who were clothed in sackcloth, fell upon their faces. And David said unto God, "Is it not I that commanded the people to be numbered? Even I that have sinned and done evil indeed? But as for these sheep, what have they done? Let thy hand, I pray thee, O Lord my God, be on me and on my father's house, but not on thy people, that they should be plagued." Then the angel of the Lord commanded Gad to say to David, that David should go up and set up an altar unto the Lord in the threshing floor of Ornan the Jebusite. And David went up at the saying of Gad, which he spake in the name of the Lord. And Ornan turned back and saw the angel, and his four sons with him hid themselves. Now Ornan was threshing wheat. And as David came to Ornan, Ornan looked and saw David and went out of the threshing floor and bowed himself to David with his face to the ground. Then David said to Ornan, "Grant me the place of this threshing floor, that I may build an altar therein unto the Lord, that thou shalt grant it to me for the full price, that the plague may be stayed from the people." And Ornan said to David, "Take it to thee. Let my lord the king do that which is good in the eyes. Lo, I give thee the oxen also for burnt offerings, and the threshing instruments for wood, and the wheat for the meat offering. I give it all." And King David said to Ornan, "Nay, but I will verily buy it for the full price. For I will not take that which is thine for the Lord, nor burn offerings without cost." So David gave it to Ornan for the place, 600 shekels of gold by weight. And David there built an altar unto the Lord, and offered burnt offerings and peace offerings, and called upon the name of the Lord. God, today, as we look at the middle part of this, God, what a great story this is. Not in the fact that 70,000 men lost their lives, but in the fact that Ornan was willing to give it all. Lord, I pray that you'd open our eyes today, that we might see what this story is really telling us. The message that it brings. I surrender all. Thank you, God, for giving me that heart, for giving me the grace, Lord, when you saved me, as I surrendered all to you. Lord, I pray that every person in this room this morning has surrendered all to you, holding nothing back. But I'm afraid, Lord, that there might be some here today that hasn't surrendered everything. They're holding back, God. Oh, God, speak to their hearts today. Loose their hearts and loose their minds that they might let go of this old world and surrender all to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. David, in this story, if you back up and read the first part of chapter 21, especially verses 1 through 14, 13, you'll find that David took a census of Israel. Now, taking a census for military purposes or governmental purposes is not something that would be considered unworthy of the Lord. It wouldn't be an abomination of the Lord. It wouldn't be a sin to do that. But what we find here is David did that. He numbered Israel just so he could look at the people around him and say, look at what I've got. It was sin, and God was sorely displeased with it.
Yeah.
And so God, and pride, you know, pride, it says pride comes before the fall.
Right.
Well, the fall is sometimes pretty rough. It depends on where you fall.
Yeah.
In David's case, when you fall into the hands of the living God, when you fall into God's grace, and it is supplication. It's a good thing to fall. And fall never hurt anybody. Matter of fact, most of you here have failed at some point in your life. But thanks be to God this morning that we have a risen Savior that picks us up and brings us out of darkness into the light when we do fall. And so David was prideful in his numbering of the nation of Israel. And so God, it brought judgment upon Israel. Now what we need to understand about this is just because David sinned didn't mean that the sin didn't affect the people around him. In other words, and what you need to know this morning is exactly the same thing. When you sin and willfully sin against God, it not only affects you, but it affects your family.
Amen.
If you ain't learned that, you will if for long. Because it absolutely does. And so we see that David was prideful. And when he fell, God, his anger was stayed, but yet 70,000 men lost their lives because of the pride of one man. Now you say, well, how is that fair in God's eyes? Well, God is a God of love and he's a God of wrath. He will not tolerate sin, ladies and gentlemen. You're either in or you're out. There is no in between. And so David learns this the hard way. And so God sends judgment. He sends the angel of the Lord with a sword over Jerusalem, set to destroy Jerusalem. And then David began to speak to God. And God's anger was appeased. And he said, hold on, angel, don't kill them all yet because of this one man's sin. But I want you to notice where the angel of the Lord stood when God had him stay his sword. He was at Jerusalem, but did it not say that he was on the threshing floor of Onan when God spoke to him and a sword was stayed there? That's important. I'll get back to that. So David was not willing to surrender his pride. I was looking at this the other day, you and I, in reality, I hate to burst your bubble, folks, but we are all made of dirt. Would you agree with that?
Amen.
We come from the dust. In Genesis, God said he picked up a handful of dirt and formed man. And then he breathed the breath of life into it. So if the average man, they say the average man weighs 170 to 180 pounds. Now, I know we've got some above average here. But the average man is about 170, 80 pounds. And so your worth as dirt is about 15 or 16 cents. And thus the saying, we ain't worth 15 cents. That's where we get that. Because dirt, in compilation to your equality, that's what you're about worth. Not in God's eyes, but in the world's eyes, 15 cents. So we are made of dirt. We're going to return to dirt one day, this old tabernacle that we live in, if you believe the Bible. And so we must surrender our lives to God. And here, I'm interested in the 22nd verse, I believe it was, where it said David told Gad, notice what God did here. When he talked to the angel, and then David began to speak and say, Lord, don't put this judgment on your people. I'm the one that sinned. Just put it on me and my house. And so the angel of the Lord, God, spoke to Gad. Did you notice that? You know who Gad was? He's the preacher. And the preacher spoke to David. Now, that puts us preachers in a precarious position. Because judgment is falling, and God speaks to us, and then we have to tell you the bad news. That's okay. And because us as preachers know that not only is there bad news that you're going to die, we know that, and we say that in our messages. We say that sin will kill you, and the wages of sin is death. But the good, we've got good news too. The good news is there's a cure. When you fall into the grace of God and let Him pick you up where you fall, and then you're cured for good.
Amen.
And so David looked at this, and he Gad spoke to him, and he says, go to the threshing floor of Ornan and buy that threshing floor from Ornan and make me an altar there. That's what he told David. And when he went down to Ornan, number one, I'm going to try. Well, let me go back here. See, we have to be willing to surrender things in our life. Totally. How many of you remember, well, y'all don't remember this, but, well, you do, but World War II, when we dropped the two bombs, one on Hiroshima and the other, General Douglas MacArthur stood on the bow of a ship with the two Japanese generals. I don't know if y'all remember this or not, but it's history. And when the Japanese generals, one of them stuck out his hand to General MacArthur to shake hands in a treaty of peace between Japan and the United States. MacArthur refused to shake his hand. The Japanese general turned around to the interpreter and said, why is he refusing to shake my hand? And they asked General MacArthur, why are you refusing to shake this man's hand? And MacArthur replied. He said, he still has his weapon of war, his sword, on his side. And until he surrenders everything, I'm not going to shake his hand. And so the general pulled off his belt, laid down his sword, and then MacArthur shook hands with the general, signifying that peace had been made. But can I tell you today that God is the same way? If you're still carrying your weapons away, if you're not willing to surrender everything in your life, you cannot shake hands with the grace of God. God is wanting you to give up everything in your life that is sin and come to Him in completion of His grace and His salvation.
Amen.
And so we see that Ornan, but notice, I want you to notice what Ornan did here. Ornan, when he met David, well, before he met David, it said up there that Ornan and his four sons were hiding in the threshing floor. Is that what it said? Well, when he saw David, he came out, but he didn't come out of hiding because judgment was on the people. And he knew, he saw the angel, he saw the blood on the sword, and he knew that in his mind, He'd already killed 70,000 in Jerusalem, and five more wasn't going to make no difference, him and his four boys. And so he hid himself from judgment until the king showed up. Y'all ain't getting this. Is that not what we do? We hide ourselves from judgment, and we hide ourselves in our sin, and we hide because we know judgment is coming. We know judgment, it comes with sin, but yet we hide ourselves until we get a glimpse of the king coming into our prayer. And the king came to the threshing floor of Ornan, and only then did Ornan come out. He came out, and he said, Ornan, I need to buy your threshing floor. And Ornan said, I want you to take it. And then if you notice in that same verse, he said, well, I'm going to give it. And in the last part of that same verse, he said, no, I tell you what, I give it all. I'm nothing but, I'm not worthy of anything. I'm just a pile of dirt. But what I'm worth, what I've got, my little piece of ground, I'm willing to give to the king. I'm not just going to give him the ground. I'm going to give him everything on the ground. I'm going to give him the oxen. I'm going to give him the instruments. I'm going to give him the wheat. I'm going to give him everything that the king requests of me. And the reason, the number one reason that Ornan gave this, number one, is the king requested it. When the king requests something in your life, you ought to be willing to give it to God, everything that you, not just your little piece of ground over here, but I'm going to get busy here. You see, God wants your life. He doesn't just want your pocketbook. He doesn't just want your social life. He wants everything, every aspect of your life. He wants your home. He wants your family. He wants your finances. He wants everything about you. And until you're willing to surrender every facet of your life, you cannot serve God the way God intends you to do. And so, Ornan says, I give it all. In 1855, Judson Van Devender, he went to a prep school and he studied art and taught art at the school and became a really prolific artist. And his dream was to become a great artist like Van Gogh. That was his life's dream. And he went to school and he was teaching at the college in 1855, teaching art and religion. But then God did something very strange, but yet not so strange. He called him to preach. And for 5 years, this Judson, I can't pronounce his name, Van Devender, he struggled for 5 years trying to make up his mind. Was he going to give up his life's dream and quit teaching art and painting to go and preach the gospel? Or was he going to follow his dream and give up on God's demand for his life? A lot of people, folks, have chose the earth, the world, as their dream instead of following the voice of God. Evander finally gave up his dream of painting and living a life as a painter and becoming famous as a painter. He gave it all up to preach the gospel. And when he surrendered his life to Christ altogether, in 1896, the song came out of his heart. And that song is the one you sing and will sing here in just a few minutes. I surrender all.
Amen.
You see, God, when this old piece of dirt that we are, we think that nothing good can come of us. God can't use anything. We're just an old hunk of dirt. But see, when you surrender everything on your dirt and everything around your dirt and everything that's connected to your dirt, then God begins to do great things in your life, on your piece of dirt, on you. That's what he does. And so Ornan surrendered all to him. You see, I could just picture this. Now Ornan David, notice what the second part. David paid the full price. The king, that's David, paid the full price for that piece of dirt. Oh, y'all are getting this. The king paid the full price for this piece of dirt. And he paid the full price for you as a piece of dirt. And everyone sitting here today, everyone that was willing to repent and give up and say, I surrender all, the king came and paid the full. He didn't say it, what a bargain this is. Listen, when you get up in the morning, you go look in the mirror. And some of y'all say, boy, God, you got cheated. You paid the full price for this? Yeah. But now there's people that are looking in that same mirror and say, boy, you got a bargain with me, God. Look how pretty I am, God. You really got a deal here, God. No, God paid the full price. It doesn't make any difference how bad you look, how good you look, how much money you got. It makes no difference to God. God bought you with a price. He paid the full price for you. You have been redeemed by the blood of Christ. And so, David, the king, he requested that. Oh, listen, there was a price. And so, David, could you imagine with me? I like to use my imagination. Sometimes too much. But could you imagine with me this morning? If Ornan, after he sold David his sole possessions, him and his boys just walked away. Now they ain't got nothing. Oh, they got an old shack they lived in, but that's all they got. Could you imagine Ornan going down the street and people asking, Ornan, did you really sell your inheritance? That land, Ornan, was in your family. It was your granddaddy's, your great-granddaddy's. It's been handed down for years, and you sold it to the king? And Ornan would say, yep. Sure did. And they say, well, Ornan, you must have a screw loose somewhere. What in the world are you thinking selling everything you've got to the king? Was it not worth anything to you? You see, that's the way a lot of people are.
Yeah.
They're not willing to give what God has already given. It wasn't theirs to start with, and they're not willing to give it to God. They want to hang on to it. In other words, people are not willing to give up the earth, the world, for heaven.
Yeah,
they want to hang on to it. And Ornan, just probably, I got to believe this, he looked at them people when they asked him, Ornan, why did you sell that land to the king? Why did you sell your inheritance to that king? And Ornan probably just smiled. And he said, have you ever met my king?
Yeah.
Do you know my king, the one I sold out to? Do you really? The Ornan says, oh, listen, I've known this king all my life. I know who he is. I know he was a little shepherd boy down there herding sheep, and he killed bears and his lion with his bare hands. Oh, that's my king. My king is the one that walked up to Goliath, the giant, with a stone and a sling, and killed that giant for the sake of Israel. I know my king. Have you ever met my king? Oh, can I tell you this morning, if you've ever met my king, the one that redeemed me by the blood of the Lamb, he's the same one that came. He's the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. He is my Savior. He's the Savior of the world. And say, who is he? He's the Son of God, the living Savior. He is Jesus today. He is who he says he is. He ain't nobody else. But if you ever meet my king, if you ever meet the one that I met at the threshing floor, I surrendered all to him. I didn't hold nothing back. And neither would you. Listen, David said to Ornan, Ornan said, I give it all. I give everything I've got to the King.
Yeah.
Because He has redeemed me.
Amen.
He stopped the judgment in my life.
Right.
Y'all ain't getting that. Because see, what He did, what the King did, when He talked to God the Father, when He talked, and God stopped the judgment on the people, and it saved his life. He was alive that day only because David interceded, the King interceded with the Father for that person, him and his family. Can you say today that the King has interceded for you and judgment will stop in your life? Listen, God said, I come not to judge the world, not to condemn the world, but to seek and to save that which was lost. That's where Ornan was. Ornan knew that his life had been stayed because of the King.
Amen.
So, Ornan, he's only mentioned three times in your Bible. This same story is related in 2 Samuel. But there's one other place that you'll find Ornan mentioned, and it's in 2 Chronicles chapter 3. We'll go there just a minute. But see, what I'm really trying to tell you this morning is Ornan was willing to give up everything that was dear to him. Everything that he loved. You say, you mean I've got to give up everything that I love to come to Christ? No, I'm not telling you that. But if it's sin related, you've got to give it up.
That's right. Amen.
If sin is in your life, you've got to get rid of it. And so Ornan said, I give it all. I'm just an old piece of dirt, and I want the King to be able to use my dirt. Now let me take you back, and I'll close. Let me take you back to where we started. Remember when the sword with the angel, when God stayed the sword, where was he? He was on the threshing floor of Ornan. Where did God instruct David to build an altar? On the threshing floor of Ornan. Now, fast forward to chapter 3 in 2 Chronicles. You can turn there if you want to. And you'll find that there, this same Ornan, he's looking. And you'll find that they're beginning to build the most beautiful building that was ever built in the entire world. And that is Solomon's Temple. In chapter 3 of 2 Chronicles, you'll find that the place, it says in verse 2 and verse 1, it says the place where they chose to build the site of the most, that old piece of dirt, same piece of dirt that Ornan sold to the King, that same piece of, you see, Ornan couldn't see it then. This is 20 years later. He didn't know the plan that God had for that piece of dirt, but that same piece of dirt is where God intended to build the Solomon's Temple, the greatest building that was ever erected. And can I tell you today, you may not see it in your life today, but this old sack of dirt that's sitting here on this pew, God may take 20 years down the road and build the most beautiful temple that you could ever see. And more than that, He may take this old piece of dirt, me and you, in 20 years from now, and you and I are going to see the most beautiful temple that was ever made, not in earth, but in heaven. And that place is called heaven. You see, Ornan was willing to surrender it all for the glory of God. And God honored that and had David's son, 20 years later, build the most beautiful place in the world on that same threshing floor.
Lord,
you say, you mean God would take this old piece of dirt and build something that glorious? Oh, listen. If you don't understand it by now, let me just clue you in real quick. You see, you may think that you're worth 15 or 16 cents, but to God, you're worth all the rubies and the gold in the world. You're precious in God's sight, and He will and He can use you as an old chunk of dirt and bring glory to Himself. It doesn't matter who you are, where you come from, what color you are. It makes no difference how much money you have. God will get glory to Himself with an old chunk of dirt like me. He'll do the same thing with you. So, in this story, out of this story, we see those precious words that Ornan said. David, I give it all. I give it all. Can you say that this morning? I give it all. But see, I believe churches are full this morning of people that have not been willing to give it all. They're holding back something, some part of their life. They're holding back some hidden sin, some unconfessed sin. Whatever it is, they're holding it back. And when we sing that song in just a minute, I surrender all. Ask yourself this question. Have I really surrendered all? Have I really given everything to God? He said, well, you're sitting there thinking, can I still hide that? These people don't know I got it. Can I still hide that? They don't know I did that. Can I still hide that? Can I get by? And God, see, God already knows. It doesn't make a difference whether I know it or not. God already knows all about you. He knows where you've been. He knows what you've done. And if you're holding back on God, listen to me. Judgment is coming. You'll have to stand before a holy God, the King. And you'll have to give an account of your life. What you did with your life after He saved you. Did you hold back? Did you not give Him all of your heart? You see, I believe a lot of people, they got saved. But they said, well, God, I'm going to go to church now. I'm going to serve you. I'm going to praise you. But don't ask me to get in that closet where I got that stuff hidden.
Come on.
Don't ask me to open that door. Because we can't go there, Lord. Where are you going to go when God stands? Do you stand before Him?
Yeah.
You're going to say, well, God, I meant to tell you about that. God said, you didn't have to. I already knew it was there.
Amen.
But you weren't willing to surrender. All listen to me this morning. Surrender everything about you to Jesus. Come on, let's sing that song. We're going to be in baptism in just a minute. But before we do, I want to give you an opportunity this morning. If you've got stuff in your life and you're not like Ornan and you're not willing to say, I give it all. If you're not willing to do that this morning, right now is your opportunity to give everything to Jesus. He is the King. He's my King. I don't know about yours. Come to Jesus this morning. Let Him take your own piece of dirt and make something that'll bring glory to God. Would you stand with me this morning?
I surrender.
Remember when you sang this song? It took this man 5 years to make a decision whether or not to follow God. And out of that decision came this very song, I surrender all. Have you surrendered all today? I want to ask Izzy if you would join me. Have you surrendered everything in your life to Him? Or you still got stuff holding back that's keeping you from following God the way you should? Maybe you've got family members that are holding you back, keeping you from letting go and serving God the way you need to. If that's you, you come this morning. You come. If God's speaking to your heart, you come this morning. Have you surrendered all? Have you met my King? Do you know Jesus as your Savior today? See, if you met Him like I met Him, you surrendered everything. Oh, you may try to take it back every once in a while. God says, no, you gave that to me a long time ago. You come. Let God have His way in your heart this morning. Some are still praying. You've got time this morning. Come and surrender all to Jesus this morning. Say, God, I'm sorry. I know I haven't lived for you like I should. I want to surrender everything in my life today. I want to give it all to you. David built an altar on worn and stretching gold once he gave it all. Where's your altar today? Have you built an altar that you can commune with God? Do you have a place that you can meet with Him? Oh, right here is one of the greatest places you'll find to meet Jesus. You come this morning. Speaking to your heart today.
Set free today. Amen. You hadn't missed on a good opportunity right now. Once like a bird in prison I dwell, no freedom from my sorrow I felt. But Jesus came and I'm
well since she was, well, even before you born. I remember those days. Isabel, last week at camp, gave her heart to Christ. She surrendered all. Isabel, you know you're saved today? All right, here we go. By the authority given me by God Almighty, I baptize thee, Isabel, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Anybody got a song on their heart they've been wanting to sing or wanting a song? Or... His name is Wonderful. testimony or a word of encouragement that maybe they'd want to share?
Have you surrendered all?
Amen.
It's easy to come out here.
There you go.
All right. Come here, Ethan. I'm getting old. I've had trouble with my buttons. All right. You got a Bible, right? Okay. You read it? Okay. All right. Here's your baptism card. This will tell you a minute. Troubles may come, heartaches. Hang on to Jesus with all of your
heart.
Surrender all. All right. God bless you. All right. If you would, stand with us. Yeah. Oh, yes. Yes, I forgot about that. April is 25 today.
Amen.
Birthday. Anybody else got a birthday? All right. Happy birthday, dog. All right. In other words, Brother Don Stavely, dismiss us, sir.
Gracious of Heavenly Father, we've come to your house this morning. We don't know whether it was a fresh room floor here before the filling was here. But you've gathered us all here together to witness a baptism, to hear your word, to hear the promise, Lord. Father God, I pray for the ones that couldn't make it for whatever reason. And I pray for the ones who chose to stay away, that you'll touch their heart or send some labor to touch them. You blessed us with words this morning that we need to meditate on. We need to think about it greatly. Have we surrendered all? If that all isn't in there, Lord, we're not done yet. We've got to look forward to being with you, being with our loved ones. Lord God, thank you for this opportunity to be in your house tonight. We pray for our country. We pray for our neighborhoods. We pray for all the ones that's on the prayer list. Father God, we ask you to go with us. Put us in the path of someone that doesn't know you. Put us in the path that we can share your glory and your love. Again, thank you for this opportunity. Let your light shine upon us and guide our steps, Lord. It's in Jesus' precious name we pray, and we all say it.
I'm Melanie. I'm a fun, caring,